living God, fall afresh on us in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. I have four sticky notes. That's all I'm going to do, just four sticky notes. It's not going to be very long, hopefully. I need to stay focused. I need to talk to my team. I need to say hello, happy Sunday. What is the point of that gospel and the collection of readings, everybody? Because I don't know about you, but I have been pouring over heart and soul all week long, all month long, trying to figure out in the gospel of Luke, why this, why now? Take the bulletins home with you. I implore you, you figure it out. You email me, you let me know, because we are a shared community here. And I'm curious to see what God speaks to you when you ponder these words from Luke. So one, there's an obvious point. That's my post-it number one. The obvious point is, you cannot serve God and wealth. Quarter done. You cannot serve God and wealth. You know what I'm curious about? If I can't serve God and wealth, which again is a binary, it's just like these two things, God or wealth, why does it have to be a binary? Couldn't my wealth be towards building God's kingdom and my relationship with my neighbor? So that's my curiosity. Could my wealth actually help? Similarly, could my poverty help in building God's kingdom? So I don't think Jesus is actually talking about wealth like a certain amount of money that you have to be able to be defiant with God or be cooperative with God. You cannot serve God and wealth. But I wonder, how does wealth, or what we have, serve God, if at all? So again, we're in Luke. If you read the little thing I put in the newsletter, then you're ahead of the game. Because I tried to mark a few themes in the Gospel of Luke, because those are the Gospels we're praying with this month. So I just want to name those out loud, because I don't want to assume you read my article. So here are my 3 points. Point number one, in Luke's Gospel, Luke, the evangelist, helps us to re-understand ourselves in the relationship with the least of these. We heard that in Amos, right? Don't you treat the poor. Right? Well, that's obvious. Again, the polar opposite, like, no one's going to do that. At least not on purpose. How do we re-understand ourselves and our relationship with the least of these? Point two, in Luke's Gospel, Luke asks us what and who we are willing to invest in. That's our time, our treasure. Please forgive me. This is not Stewardship Sunday. I think a few people are freaking out. We have a committee. I know. No, that's later. That's later. But for this gospel, there is an invitation to consider, right, in the Gospel of Luke, who and what do we invest in? Our time, our treasure, negative and positive sometimes. And finally, the third point that I want to offer as context for Luke is that Luke reminds us that God's joy and the kingdom, or we call it God's dream, right, are found in the reversal of status and identity that the world gives. Are found in the reversal of the status that the world gives. We're halfway done. I have 2 post-it notes down. Okay, so the reversal, right? So if you're poor, you're rich. If you were invited up to the front, or if you were invited to the party, but you're not sure how the host treats you, but you're invited to the front, the people who took up that first seat are brought to the back, right? You get it, last shall be first, all of that, all of the reversals, right? So again, if I've got wealth, what do I do with it? Can I do anything for God? And does that put me in front or in the back? If we were linear. So those are the 3 points that I wanted to remind you. I'm not going to quiz you. I won't quiz you. But I do want to name the background, because this story is still odd to me. And I have read enough scholars to say that they're still debating what actually is really going on. Like this parable, it's not true, it's just a story that Jesus says to speak to people in their truth and in their own experience. There's a rich guy, he had a manager who had status in the community. That manager was responsible for those relationships that the rich man had bestowed on him with all of his renters. So he gets fired because the rich man hears that he didn't do so well with keeping his stuff all right. And he might have taken advantage. Who knows? Maybe the rich man was like, you were taking advantage of my renters. We don't know why he got fired. But he gets fired. Right before he gets fired, though, he says, what can I do to secure my own future? To himself. He calls in everybody. All right, so Christy, how much do you owe? She's like, I don't know, like 100-something. Like, I don't even know how. That's like 3 years' wages for me. You know what? Sit down quickly, just write. I'll just say 50. Some scholars say that he was able to do that because he took off some money too. So he was like, oh, he was so kind. You don't have to pay me my tax, but just give what is owed to this guy. All right, Penny, how much do you owe? Oh, about like 80, whatever, whatever. Okay, do half. And so all of a sudden, Christy and Penny, I mean, we were friends before. But now they're like, oh, Jocelyn, we're really friends because you got me out of debt and I was still in good graces with the rich man. And now I have a relationship that's a little more tied to the two of you. So when I'm fired, because you didn't know I was fired, I'm like, hey, Penny. So I was thinking, and you kind of need a job? Could you vouch for me? Right? Hey, Christy, I was needing a place to stay, and because we are indebted to each other for caring for each other, ideally they will help. At least that's how it was in Jesus' time. I don't know how it is with us now. So this story is odd because Jesus says, you need to be that shrewd. You need to be that shrewd with what is given to you. But this guy was dishonest. I don't want to tell our children to lie. I don't want to tell them to steal, right? Don't lie. Don't steal, right? But what are we doing with the thing that has been given to us? Even the ways of the world, this man figured it out very shrewdly. And you got the rich guy, what is his? And for some reason, there was some kind of right relationship then that became of Christy and Penny in our situation. So I'm still confused because I don't like it. I don't like this gospel at all. I don't want to teach my kids how to be shrewd of the world and figure it out, right? But I have to tell you a story. So my daughter, Ale, I mean, you know, I have three, but I'll tell you about one. She's four, and she goes to bed. I'm a terrible mom. She goes to bed hungry half the time. And not because I don't offer her food, she just doesn't want the food that I give her. So when she goes to bed at night, after a certain time, I limit the offerings. You can get your carrots or your celery or your cheese. And she's like way disappointed because she really wants some sweets. So one night I fell asleep. She was supposed to have fallen asleep. Jess startles me and wakes me up and says, your daughter is downstairs rummaging through the fridge. I'm like, what am I supposed to do with it? I'm like, right? So I kind of lash. One, I know I'm in trouble with my wife. But two, I kind of giggle because I'm like, well, good for her. She figured it out. I wasn't feeding her. The food is there. She can figure it out. I go downstairs and I see evidence of what she was able to get. So in that morning when she woke up, we were having breakfast, and I said, so, it looks as though you are hungry. She's like, I told you I was hungry before I went to sleep. Great. So it looks as though you got a croissant out of the cabinet. And she looked at me. You weren't awake, how did you know? She said, oh, because I saw the chair there because you had to climb, and I saw the wrapper on the floor because you didn't throw it away in the garbage. The next time, could you throw it away in the garbage box? So all of a sudden, she looked at me, she's like, okay, yeah, great. How shrewd was my daughter in figuring out how to feed herself? children of light are not. Hate to break it to you all, and choir, especially you, I imagine that we are all children of light here. We are all the people that got out of our homes when it's raining to be here together because it was important, even though we live stream. You don't want to do that. You want to be here. Children of light. Are we this shrewd in matters that have to do with our community? Are we this shrewd when someone in our community needs to eat? Have we figured it out with enough tenacity and purpose to ensure that their needs are met? I wonder. The other day we heard that Home and Hope, a neighborhood partner that we have been living and ministering with for quite some time now, is closing. Four times a year, we would open up Foot Hall, we would put up tents, we would get groceries and help to feed people, and we would have relationship over dinner. Tons of people, 60 or 70 people have been doing this for quite some time now.
22 years,
thanks Chris, 22 years, 22 years. And now it's over. And during the pandemic, it was difficult. We had to figure things out, and people were great. They were buying groceries, $150 a week, you know, for a family, bringing it to whatever hotel they were staying in, and now that's come to an end. And I wonder for St. Paul's, in this moment, as we restart, and we re-engage, and we look at this gospel in Luke, and we say, huh, well, just because Home and Hope is over, and our relationship is over, we know that hunger and homelessness still wreck many of our families here. What is it for us to do? Or what is it for us to listen to? Or what is it for us to be present to in this moment? I would even say the same thing with rubbish. Lots of changes, and it has been decades that we have been offering the service here. For the day or the two, whatever those days are, that people from all over our county find relationship through stuff. Right? That is a legacy that right now we're wondering as a community, what do we do if we don't have people doing this service? Right? So I think this gospel, although I don't have answers for you, just gets me curious about lots of different ways we can approach our own discernment as we muddle through our way of being in common with each other and in community here. So, wealth and God, and you can serve both, but can they both serve a purpose to glorify God? You have pieces of paper in your pews. Why don't you go ahead and grab it if you're not at the edge, the inside edge or the outside edge. I actually have a practice for us. Please forgive me, maybe it's the teacher in me still. I will not correct whatever you write. I probably won't even know it's from you. These are all anonymous, but you have a piece of paper and there are pens or writing utensils in your pews. Please help each other. I have a question for you, and this will be part of our offering. So it's just an invitation. If you don't want to do it, don't worry. You don't have to be a little upset with me. Just don't do it. But if you want to do it, great, we're going to do this. So on the piece of paper on one side, again, I'm preaching to the choir. So many of you have already given your life to be of service to those in need, particularly as we know them through St. Paul's. Can you just write down a few of the things that you do? No one's looking for gold stars here. Just for your own benefit, your own thinking through, how active are you in either volunteerism or gifting, right, through money or your wealth or the things that you have, your time, that you do? You might have told people about it, maybe not. Maybe this is just for you. Just write that on one side. I'll give you about a minute or so. For St. Paul's, if you want to focus in general in your life, if that's helpful. Does anyone need a piece of paper or a pen? Oh, inquire. You all saw that on the altar rail? Perfect. Thank you. I think I got the numbers right. you're curious about perhaps another way you can share your wealth or share your time or share your perspective or share your support. The Outreach Committee was beginning conversations with the International Rescue Committee, and they've been supporting refugees from lots of different countries. And we're just curious right now to see if that is an opportunity for St. Paul's to coordinate our best efforts to support a family or two as they make their transition here to the States. So that's what I would write on my, maybe do something like that. So on one side, the thing that you're already doing, the other side, something that you're thinking, maybe curious about, of wanting to do. And this, my friends, is our practice with one another, and I have an invitation for you to, you know those gift bags every time people do presents? Sometimes it's the easiest thing, you don't have to wrap it. When the ushers are coming down with the plates, I'm going to ask them also to bring this bag, and if you wouldn't mind just putting your card in here. And this too will be brought up at the offering as an offering to God of the gifts.